Good afternoon. We're doing something different today as we honor this nation's fallen heroes this weekend. Carry the Load has been on a mission to remind Americans of the true meaning of Memorial Day and to raise money for some special causes like this Dallas gym, which is changing the lives of adaptive athletes, military and civilian. We spent several months in here documenting what they do, and we're devoting this hour to a new kind of courage.
Even without anyone in it, there's something about it. There's an energy.
The X Factor is different to each person. I don't know what it is, but it's special.
I call it a place that people can come and be who they are. It's about being here, being present, and allowing others to be present with you. It can tell you about transformation. I believe that there is a hero in every single one of us. All I want to do is be attuned to when they show up so I can rise up and answer the call.
A new kind of courage. Sponsored by your North Texas GMC dealers and Veterans Land Board.
We can change the statistic, which is that 22 veterans commit suicide every day in this country. It's a human issue. How do you stop the downward spiral? Empowering people. When they fall, say, hey, it's progress, not perfection. Do it again. Do it a little bit wiser, do it a little bit harder, and you do it again. That's what people take away from this program.
Welcome to our gym.
This is a place of starting over.
My job here is to create optimization for you. Okay, that's it. It's my job to create optimization for you, right? That's opportunity to grow. It's up for you guys to work and to put in the time so that there are breakthroughs, right? So all I can do is apply the opportunity, and then we can see how far we go and how short of a time. So we have 9 weeks, okay? 9 weeks may sound like a long time, but it'll be gone like that, man.
Everyone who comes here is looking for that new start.
And there's a point in this 9 weeks where something's gonna get hard, you're gonna get sick, something's gonna hurt. Not injury hurt, but just pain that's gotta be pushed out. We're gonna have to flesh that out, okay? So in those times, rely on each other, rely on the staff, okay? Because we're gonna be the ones that fill the void and help you and pick you up in those times. So as a community, we're all strengthened together. Just honesty is everything. This thing with open transparency, it works, man. If we start to try to find an easier, softer way and it's excuses, I'm gonna call you out on that. Remember, like, what we wanna target is things that are like, man, I know I want to do that, but it's going to be really hard. Like, let us create the kind of achievement path for you, and then you guys are just going to walk it.
Many of them are wounded warriors, and most of them are amputees.
Because I can promise you, a lot of my best games in football were where it was when I was overcoming an injury, or I was sick, or like I had to get through something, and it took my mind off of it, and I had like the best game of my whole life. When we're vulnerable, that's an opportunity for the rest of the community, the tribe, to lift us up. We have breakthroughs, breakthroughs, breakthroughs. I want to find out about how you got hurt, what happened, what's the road been since you got hurt that's led you here.
I got hurt in Afghanistan. It was a dismounted IED.
I was injured in Afghanistan in 2010.
Stepped on an IED, lost both legs immediately.
I was shot in a gun battle in Iraq through the left knee joint, and it caused me to have my leg amputated above the knee.
Being able to just be, I don't know, nobody really knows me here, but I just want to be myself again. That's kind of hard for, I guess, for y'all to understand that, but just to just find myself.
There you go.
I actually understand that really well, because this is where I started over too.
Come on, man. Come on. Come on, keep going. Hey,
there it is.
There it is.
What was his first
one? VR.
David Vobora, founder of the Adaptive Training Foundation.
So you guys know me, all of you know me, as a matter of fact. So Dave Vobora, founder, head trainer, whatever you want to call it. Don't get too formal.
I'm a veteran too, but not of the military. Of football.
2008, I was drafted as a St. Louis Ram. Played there 9 and 10, and then played for the Seattle Seahawks in 11. Had a catastrophic shoulder injury in 2011 with the Seahawks that resulted in a couple different surgeries. As I rehabbed from that, I got healthy enough to play in the league, but as a result of numerous concussions, traumatic brain injuries. As I looked at what my life was and where I saw my life going as I started this gym, and I recognized that my gifts could match the needs of those right in front of me, it was time to turn the page, and I never thought I would say those words. I thought they would literally have to drag me off of a football field when my body had failed, but it just turns out that I found something that had such a profound impact on my life that I couldn't stop giving. Originally, it was just a gym for elite athletes, because that's all I knew. But then I met a man that changed everything. I met Travis Mills, one of 5 living quadruple amputees who lost all 4 limbs serving our great nation in Afghanistan. It was like the hot chick at the bar. I saw a guy with no arms, no legs, and I was amazed by the way he was moving and the biomechanics that went into just him being upright. I walked right up to him. I said, "When was the last time you worked out?" He said, "Look, I don't want to make you feel like an idiot, right? But I don't have arms or legs." Immediately, I said, "Well, why does that matter? I understand that you were wounded, but you're healed now. Even though you look different, what's keeping you from tapping back into the physicality and competing physically?" And he was willing to go, "Man, this guy's bold, but he's confident, and I'm gonna take a chance on it." "What are you most afraid of?" He said, "Falling. Gravity catches up real quick. No arms, no legs, remember? I told you this before." So we used that as his first beginning of training. I used bands to catch him or my hands, and at times I let him fall. He began to desensitize that fear. He began to trust himself and trust me, and through that we had mental and physical breakthrough after breakthrough.
I recognized when he was doing 100-pound sled pulls on the turf over here and looking at my NFL players training at the same time and going, "Oh, does your pinky toe hurt? That's a shame. I wish I had toes." Suddenly the collective group all had a level and a gear beyond their known capacity. So what I watched was a transformation for all people. It was really the genesis of me starting ATF, the Adaptive Training Foundation.
Through that, I recognized, wait a second, there's probably more people like him out there.
People like retired Marine Corporal Blake Watson.
Deployed to Afghanistan. I took a step out away from the wall, and when I did, I knelt down on top of a pressure plate IED. The IED exploded, lost my left leg above the knee.
I went from being in the best shape of my life to being being an elite member of a group, doing this incredible stuff that I was doing, to having all that taken away from me, and my ability to walk and my ability to run and play sports and do things like that I thought were normal, stripped away from me in one moment.
We brought him into our redefined program at ATF. It's 9 weeks long.
There it is.
Oh, mother.
May not sound like a lot.
I make you want to say good words.
But it is.
That sucks.
When you've lost a limb, and rehabilitation has only gotten you so far.
It's like my drug, man. I mean, I sat around for 6 months after retiring, trying to figure out what in the world I was going to do with my life. I had no sense of purpose, no direction. Just looking for a reason to even wake up every single day.
This is a place where adaptive athletes can feel safe to challenge themselves, to push further, and have a group to belong to.
Coming in here, man, only for an hour a day, 3 times a week, there was still 3 hours a week that someone wanted me somewhere and I had a purpose. And so I just embraced it. I made this place my sanctuary and I dove headfirst into it.
There's a quote we use in here quite often, and it talks about, don't let what you can't do affect what you can do. That was the motto that I lived my life in football, and I still live my life. And so now to take that same mindset and apply it inside the gym, it's amazing to watch these people that kind of embody what I felt like I did for so long in football. It was overcoming all odds and not letting an obstacle be a reason why you ran into that roadblock. What Adaptive Training Foundation does so brilliantly is understand, like, hey, look, this may be a block, but how do we adapt and modify around it so that we're still pursuing a better version? There's struggle and triumph, but what the struggle does is it offers the opportunity for triumph. Without rain, you couldn't enjoy sunshine. And so for us here, it's about making sure that they understand the mentality that's necessary, and that my football career did a lot of that for me.
When I retired from the NFL, I thought I started a gym to enhance athletic ability. I thought it was about the physical, but instead, it's about the hope. Recalibrating the physical body and feeding the souls of my clients.
There's a lot more things I could do with my leg strength that I just wasn't able to before.
You know, I can hop down, open a door if I need to. I can lift weights. I can, on the Supercat machine, you know, the first time I came in here, I could probably press 125 pounds on that thing. It was real weak, my knee gave out. But I'd say a couple weeks ago, I did 600 pounds. You know, so that's that just speaks volume to what we could do inside this gym if you just embrace it.
Blake is the glue that binds this place.
Welcome to our gym.
He used to serve from behind the sight of a rifle, but he now serves behind the lens of a camera.
Watching the transformations that happen and the miracles that happen, where you can see in their eyes, it clicks. It clicks over and they actually fully grasp onto it. They trust the program and they dive head in.
That's an epic shot of the end. So, that was great.
Blake tells ATF stories, hero stories, just like his. And who better to do it? So I hired him.
It makes me not care if I sit here and work on it for 6 hours after work when I get home, and then I work on it for 8 hours when I'm at work. It doesn't matter because it's, you know, what I'm getting to do. I'm getting to tell these guys' story. It needs to be captured and it needs to be told. You know, look what I did. I overcame this. You know, I didn't let the fact that I got shot in the head with an RPG affect me. I'm gonna go run an Ironman. You know, middle finger, Taliban. Thank you.
The body is like an instrument. If you work with it enough, you can play beautiful music, even with some broken strings. This is Sergio Gonzalez.
I love music. Music is definitely my medicine for sure.
I was hurt. Afghanistan 2010, stepped on a landmine. Suffered some muscle loss, some bone loss, had some bone grafts.
From that first day I met him, he wanted just one thing.
There you go.
To be himself again.
I just want to be myself again.
Yeah.
You can see it in his face.
Faster on the way up. Throw your hands. Yes, that's, now we're almost jumping. That's what I want.
And then we got to it.
Bet you it's a PR. I don't even have to look at the clock. I bet you it's a PR.
We uncovered that he is a fighter.
Come on. Come on. Come on, come on, come on, come on, come on, come on. Dig in, dig in. Throw your hands. Throw your hands. Throw your hands.
Pain? What's that? He embraced the suck every day. He was relentless.
Come on, man. Come on. Come on, keep going.
There it is.
Woo! We are 49.3.
Oh! What?
Yeah, I'll never forget about this place. I'm never gonna forget about anybody here. Have my motivation back. Have my drive to be better. To challenge myself every day like I used to. You know, I'm not just a guy who had a very short-lived military career. You know, it's a place I can come and truly show what kind of athlete I am and who I am inside and not.
And you're doing a lot better now.
Week 3, yes sir.
Every day is hard, every day is challenging.
Yeah, extend, push extend.
Dying. Exhausted.
Like when I leave out of here, I'm dripping, I'm just drenched. I go through like 3 or 4 shirts because I'm so sweaty.
That's Army Sergeant Mike Smith, who lost his arm in 2012.
A lady hit me on my motorcycle. She was texting and driving, hit me, it threw me over the guardrail on the highway in Nashville, Tennessee. And before I could hit the ground, another vehicle came and knocked my arm off. This is after deployments. So I went through that moment of, I served my country, senior NCO. How could I lose my arm on a motorcycle versus in combat, like what I've been trained to do my whole adult life?
It's easy to think like that, but I started this program because of Wounded Warriors. It wasn't until after I got it going that I realized how many more civilians are out there who could benefit from what we're doing.
There's over 200,000 amputations in America every year. 15,000 new spinal cord injuries, over 200,000 living spinal cord injuries. These are statistics that prove that this need is not just central to veterans or civilians.
We now have ATF classes where we mix it all up.
No two injuries are the same, but everyone's all going through kind of the same struggles in life.
You got that avalanche coming towards you, you gotta get out of there.
Warriors are sweating alongside civilians, both with incredible stories.
It resembles exactly what to the line unit I was in, to my platoon, and just the love.
And they inspire each other.
Lawrence, have you met him?
Okay. Hey!
Let's do this.
Nah, no pull.
Lawrence Green is one of our warriors. He lost both legs in a motorcycle.
All right, get yourself balanced. He'll make you work today.
Go for it. I got y'all D-weight. Right. His injuries were barely healed.
Okay, stick it. Get your weight forward. Stick it. Forward. Yeah. Come on. I'm not going to help you. Come on, hip through. Turn.
You want to fix it? When he came to us, he was determined to become the best version of himself.
Every single muscle in your body is firing right now.
One of his classmates is Angela Bridges.
I had a virus that attacked my heart. So I had a large blood clot in my left ventricle. My heart was about a handful. Pieces kept breaking off, going to my leg. And so we ended up doing amputation and removing the clot.
Regardless of how people get here, we focus on building them up. Not just physically, but mentally.
In this environment, working out, like, I'm not any different than anybody.
Sometimes the first breakthrough is just accepting what used to be a limb is now a nub.
At first, I didn't want to look at it. I didn't want to touch it. I was just, because they're telling you, you're supposed to massage it and desensitize it. And I couldn't. I was mad at it.
9, 10. Oh. There it is.
Acceptance of a lost limb is a big thing. Getting a new limb is even bigger.
I get to try on a leg.
Yeah, it's a pretty good day.
The advances in prosthetics is tremendous. And it's just profound to see the abilities for these guys to be increased because of what modern technology can do.
It's just been a long road. It's been almost 5 years, so it's almost become numb to the feeling. I'm just ready for it to finally happen.
So it's got a gyroscope. It kind of detects where it is in space. And when it detects so much weight on the toe, the knee will release and kick. So much weight on the heel, it'll lock up and be stiff. This computerized technology continues to advance.
If nothing else, it's hope. It's just a reason to wake up and push forward tomorrow. It's just some little things that you can hold on to like that. Because now I can go in and I can get back in the gym in the morning and I can get upright. And that's just one step closer to finally not having to sit in a wheelchair anymore.
Tonight's an amazing night and an emotional one. I want to pause for a second if we could and say a quick prayer. For those of you that don't know, Blake was taken in the hospital today. They've sort of narrowed down some things and ruled some things out, which is the good news, but they're still not sure what's going on. If you would, bow your heads with me in prayer. Lord God, we just lift Blake Watson up tonight. Blake means so much to every single one of us. In this moment, Lord, we know that you're behind everything and everything happens for a purpose, Lord. And so we just trust you in this moment, in this tough moment. We just love you, Lord, and we just love Blake. And we just thank you that you're an all-knowing God and that your hand is behind this. Amen. Brother of mine is in the hospital right now. And tonight I'll definitely be heavy-hearted for that. I know he would want us to go on and still enjoy this night.
Just gonna eat and enjoy the company and then get sad later.
That night was tough. Not just because we didn't know what was wrong with Blake. Graduation is always hard.
It is really hard for me. Each one of these groups become family. Each one of these people, they have a profound impact on me.
After 9 weeks at ATF.
You love every single one of these guys and gals like your own family, and you make sure that they know that. And they're allowed to have rough times. I mean, we all are. The hard times are a given. It's life. And that necessary adversities help you to become a better version of yourself. And that's what we preach here. So if you can do it in the gym, why can't we do it outside the gym? And that's part of just living life together.
Sergio finally got out of that dark place and got what he'd been wanting.
Ever since coming here, it's been really easy to leave my excuses and all that BS at the door. You know, I can come here. I've come here this past 9 weeks and just felt like I'm just accepting, and I have a place where I can come and prove myself, you know. My military career was pretty short-lived, but, you know, my life's not, and I still got a lot more to live for. And David, Maddie, everybody involved, you know, I just love each and every one of y'all. Athletes especially, you know, y'all are truly an inspiration to my life. And I'm always gonna hold this place close to my heart.
Like I said, day one, they said, what do you want out of this program? I said, I just want to be me again. I want to find myself. I want to get back to the old me. And, you know, I'm definitely there. And there's nothing in my way anymore. And the sky's the limit now.
The work that you guys have put in has been profound, and it really has been an amazing transformation. So really proud of each of you. This is a family, and all the work that y'all put in and the hours, the time, I know y'all enjoy it, but this is something that's so meaningful to have people come and become a part of this story and champion these athletes. It's really awesome.
With conviction, I can say that every person I've ever trained in this place could not get what we've offered them and what they've taken anywhere else. The athletes of the Adaptive Training Foundation remind me every day that I have to surrender to win.
I'm in here working out, training, trying to get back into shape so I can get on some prosthetics. This gym means a lot to me. That made me realize that I'm capable of much more than I ever thought I was.
If there's one thing I'm proud of the individual stories, and I'm blessed by each one of them. This gym is special.
If you can't feel the atmosphere right now, something is wrong with you. You probably need to leave and go home. Like, if you can't feel like how close everybody is, people that I've never met in my life are just.
I love you too.
From there, the happy ending got even better. It turned out that Blake just had to have his gallbladder removed. I say just because, well, it's Blake.
I knelt down on top of a bomb and I'm still here. The gallbladder ain't stopping me.
After Blake got out of the hospital, he went to amazing new heights. Several of our guys did. But that's a story to be continued. It's a gym for warriors and civilians, most of whom are missing limbs. They are my heroes, my tribe, my family. I started it 2 years ago because I was missing something too. It's called the Adaptive Training Foundation, or ATF.
A new kind of courage. Sponsored by your North Texas GMC dealers and Veterans Land Board.
Things took an unexpected turn in my life. A series of injuries led to my retirement. I didn't cope well. I numbed myself. I didn't know who David was without football. And it led to a spiral of a downhill decline that ultimately led me to rock bottom. Never had I been so scared in my whole life. So I just numbed myself. It wasn't long until spending $2,000 to $3,000 a week pain medication, anything I could get just to make sure I didn't go into withdrawal. I did a 7-day detox in Seattle. I lost 34 pounds. I had 2 seizures. I remember opening my eyes and there was a cold plate of tuna casserole that lay on the table right next to me. So as I stood
pushed myself up and a tremor short-circuited my stability and I fell powerlessly, crashed hard onto the tile floor. I'll never forget the sound of the plate shattering. I'm talking about playing in the NFL weeks prior to not being able to hold a plate, not being able to sit up. Because I was so embarrassed, ashamed, humiliated. And I remember I was on my hands and knees and I was trying to scrape up lumps of tuna casserole and broken plate in my hands. And yeah, the nurses restrained me because they thought I was trying to use the plate to cut myself. That was my lowest point in life, but I got through it and I came to Dallas, my new home. That's when I started the gym for pro athletes. And eventually, I met and started training the amazing veteran, Travis Mills.
And started training Travis, and I watched breakthrough after breakthrough after breakthrough for both him and for everybody else in the gym. That's when I recognized, hey, look, this is my purpose. My purpose is to help these individuals that thought that optimization or physical competition was no longer on the table for them. Driving home late from work one day, wife's yelling at me, almost an hour late. Kids are screaming, she's dealing with it all. Getting up to a light and I recognized that I could book it through this strip mall, through a Starbucks parking lot, and hopefully beat one stoplight to get home a whole whopping 30 seconds faster. But at this point, every single second that passed was a negative for me and my wife in this case. And out of the corner of my eye, I see a wheelchair. And right then I turn, I take a quick glance and I see there's a guy with no legs, but I turn back to my driving and in that moment I felt this deep tug on my heart, something telling me you have to stop and talk to this man.
I was in the Marines.
So this is where I met Brian Aft.
We were deployed to Afghanistan.
I literally got out of my car as fast as I possibly could.
We were crossing over an irrigation ditch, and when my turn came, me and my dog jumped over.
Brian's truck was right here. He was here in his wheelchair when I parked right there and rushed up on him. And I remember him sitting here thinking, I assume he was thinking, oh God, how am I gonna take this guy out?
And as I was pushing off the ground, kaboom.
And I said, look, when did you get blown up? And from that moment, I was amazed because he didn't say much. Like he literally probably only said five words to me.
I'm bad about just trying to bottle it up and shove it to the side. And
I didn't know that he was going through the biggest battle of his life. He had just gotten out of detox. He'd been severely addicted to heroin, and he was going to bed every single night with a pistol next to him.
I'd probably be doing a lot of drugs until I just killed myself, pretty much. And that's honest.
Brian didn't even say yes. I'm not sure that he said yes, but I asked him to come to my gym and train at 10 a.m. the next day.
I don't want pity, sympathy, anything. I mean, I'm just a dude trying to be a dude.
It was hard work, but he kept coming. We were always there to help push physically and emotionally.
You can still make things pretty awesome for yourself. Especially if you have a really good support group and people that care about you.
And ATF has given him reason to leave his house, to move forward, to plan for a future.
His mom saw the change, and so did I. And we just bonded. Brian became like a brother instantly to me.
I've often thought about where Brian F would be if we hadn't met in this parking lot that day. God told me to stop that day. I can promise you that that tug on my heart was a spiritual speed dial directly from our higher power. It told me, because believe me, the last thing on my mind was trying to do more work. But when you recognize that your gifts match the needs of others right in front of you, it's not by your choice. Your choice is to listen when that call is made. And I chose to listen that day, and I'm so happy that Brian Aft is still here and that Brian Aft isn't a statistic, because that statistic sucks. And suicide sucks. And if more people recognized that they're here and that purpose for them
comes through building into others, this world would look significantly different.
It's pretty incredible watching that. I mean, you know, a guy's never done it before. They're throwing the prosthetics up inside of a harness and they're running on their hands. You talk about a cardio workout right there, man. That's conditioning like nobody's business.
That's Blake Watson, retired Marine Corporal and a good friend of Brian's.
I've known Brian for a very long time. We were patients at Brook Armory Medical Center in San Antonio.
So I met Brian in the parking lot, and then Brian called Blake the day after our first workout and said, hey man, I got a gym for us. He brought Blake down, and instantly it was like one of my buddies from high school. I mean, I have Blake, former athlete, just a ton of similarities in how we approach life.
I'll never forget sitting in my room one night, telling myself that I was gonna die in 6 months or end up in jail if I didn't fix my problem because of the pain pill addiction that I had. And about 3 days later is when Brian called me and told me he had met this guy. He wanted me to come work out at his gym.
Yeah, Blake ran foot patrol one day in Afghanistan, and when he turned a pivot to look back and clear an alley for his guys as he ran point, he knelt down on top of an explosive device, and that IED blew, and it set him up in the air.
Couldn't feel anything from my belly button down. That's the point I realized that it was me that blew up. I was in total shell shock, so it was just, all I heard was like wind blowing and my ears ringing. I saw boots running all over the ground in front of me, and it was just a dust cloud everywhere. And I remember trying to roll over, and when I did, I couldn't move. And I was just like, that's it, like I'm done. I just wanted to close my eyes and just let it be over. And the second that I shut my eyes, I heard this voice in my head that said, not yet, I'm not finished with you. There was a reason that I'm still here, and I believe that very much so. So I put that on my arm, that I was saved by his grace on December 14th of 2010.
But Blake, Brian, and I, so many of these warriors especially, or people, adaptive athletes that have gone through traumatic injury, we've all dealt with some type of addiction. And it may just be temporal inside of the hospital, and then you have to kind of wean yourself off if you have it, or like Blake, Brian, and I that said, look, I don't care what I put in my body, I just don't want to feel. Because I felt at this level before, and that's what being truly alive felt like. And so you try to find yourself in this cul-de-sac looking to get out, and it spirals out of control.
Going through all the pain and the trauma that I did, there was a lot of painkiller, a lot of opiate medication, as well as a lot of anxiety, depression medication.
I never thought I was gonna get out of it. Spending every single day trying to figure out why I even needed to wake up that day.
I don't care what brought you to this place. It's a place that you can come and be completely raw, unfiltered, who you are, pain, darkest hour, brightest hour, whatever it is. This is a place where you can come and you can become a better version of yourself.
30 days I was clean off of all the drugs. I was back in the gym, I was working out, new sense of purpose.
It's not about sympathy. It's not about what just happened, it's about what's gonna happen because you hold the keys to your life. And that, as soon as Brian figured that out, and Blake figured that out, when Blake figured out that he could serve but no longer pointing a rifle, when he could serve by pointing a lens of a camera, and he could tell other stories, that's when I feel like Blake took a very pivotal swing from being a consumer of the ATF program to being the glue.
Get to Blake, as soon as you get to Blake, you're done.
It keeps everything binded together. That's what we strive for at the gym. Help people find their purpose. To go out there, to put a goal in front of them that's almost impossible, that they may even think is impossible, but then map the way, map the program and the plan for them to achieve. Yes, we help them get in shape, but we sharpen them here so they can go outside of our walls and utilize the new self, the new them, and compete at the highest level. Two of our guys know a lot about what that looks like.
If you say, let's have a hand clapping competition, probably gonna look at me and be like, yeah, how you gonna get that done? I'm gonna figure it out. I mean, something. But I'm gonna beat you. I'm gonna win.
That's Army Sergeant First Class Mike Smith. One of the first things I did when Mike came down to our gym was I sat him down and I told him it wasn't about him. Confused, he looked at me like I was crazy. And I said, look, your training is about you, but while you're training, it's not about you. We expect you to be present and be present with others training. It's not about looking at yourself. It's about championing others and cheering them on, becoming part of their story. The first time I met Mike, I knew I liked him, but I knew that we had to get some certain things through to him and get him to look through a new pair of glasses before he could ever be successful athletic.
You can always learn from somebody else. You can always take inspiration from somebody else. I'm not gonna let this arm stop me from being the person that I wanna be.
With one arm, he's taking on the world. He's preparing to take on the whole world with what he's about to do. But the good news is, he's got the perfect training partner to prepare with him. Former Army Sergeant Carlos Colon. Carlos came to the gym. I remember when he walked in thinking, this dude is a Spartan warrior. A, he was in better shape than me. B, the scars on his face, you know, being blind in one eye and having the prosthetic, it was just incredible to stand and talk and be in his presence. English is his second language. His whole story of how he was hit, how he got back on the gun and continued to fight, even though his eye was hanging and his whole face was bloody. Half of his hand blown off, ears blown out. His team leader had to restrain him to get him off the gun because he was back in the fight. And this is all the first 5 minutes I've met this man.
Like, I don't regret nothing, but I would have done it again. I would have gone to Iraq, to Afghanistan, because I loved them. I don't know. But I'm proud to say that they were like war injuries, you know? I'm proud of my scar.
Everything that I tell Carlos to do, he does, he nails it, and without even taking a breath, he looks at me and says, what's next? I'm like, dude, you just did 25 pull-ups. Breathe. Pause. And he's just that type of guy. There is no quit. There is no next level. He constantly is, we're, as coaches, we're making sure he's not overtraining. That's his risk. He just wants to press and press and press. And I'm just so honored to call him one of my athletes and call him a brother and a friend because he's a single dad, served his country. You know, he's the epitome of what a coach's dream is.
They shot a rocket for pro grenade. I think when I went through, I put in my hand. So I took all my fingers, my face. One piece of the RPG went through the helmet.
It's hard to believe now, but when Carlos was serving in Afghanistan.
Right here. That's me.
He was so severely wounded.
This is my head, if you could see. This is before all my surgery, because he should have bones all over. So the explosion, it blew up all these bones.
He lay still in a coma for over a month.
That's my Purple Heart, the one that President Bush gave me. He went before I woke up from the coma. So by the time he took the picture, I was just sleeping. I wish I would have been awake so he would have just put me in person.
And that's how I broke.
Mike Smith's doctors tried to rebuild him too after his arm was knocked off by a car following a motorcycle crash.
They put it back on and tried to save it, but they couldn't.
Look, I haven't seen this picture in probably 3 years. It reminds me where I came from and just reminds me everything that I went through. Yeah. I've come a long way.
Okay, hands together.
Let's pray.
Dear God.
Dear God.
Thank you for this food.
Thank you for this food.
Thank you for my family.
Thank you for my family.
Thank you for my friends.
Thank you for my friends.
Lay, what are you thankful for?
Brian and Blake and Mommy.
Good. May we always defend the weak and always do what's right. Amen. Yeah! Prodigal son has returned.
I believe in everything happens for a reason.
This is amazing to watch these guys today, cross training in the pool and actually swimming.
Mike and Carlos.
Kick, kick, burn these up. Fast, 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 fast.
Have been training.
There you go. 10 on this side, 10 on that side.
At a level that few able-bodied people do.
They go on to compete outside of our walls. So what do you guys think, a little swim competition? Carlos has zero quit. Like,
He does not give in to pain.
We put them in a class of their own at ATF so we could specifically train them for elite athletic competitions.
Carlos has got his first ever Olympic length triathlon this weekend, this Sunday.
Atta boys, go Carlos!
Just gotta go back to our army training. You just gotta go someplace in your mind and block out all the pain. And stake your claim. Good job. Don't fly towards the sun. You gotta crawl before you run. With every step you take, you gotta learn.
Nice run. There you go. Right up the hill, brother. Go, go, go. Nice job.
The Lake Placid Skeleton Bobsled Olympic Training Center. My goal is to make the actual USA team. That's my goal.
I can't imagine a better guy suited to go compete with able-bodied people because that's how he sees himself.
If I hadn't lost my arm, would I be doing this now? Probably not. This is the reason why I train so hard, and now I'm putting all my training to use.
Start four from Mike. Track is clear from Mike. Curve 10.
You can't let your injury define who you are. You know what I mean? Like, you can't allow your injury to become your crutch. It hurt. It scared me. I think it scared me more than anything. I'm glad that they pushed me as hard as they did because now it's all paying off. Everybody else has done four runs. They do four runs a day and I've done eight.
In a 50.07 downtime for Mike.
I'm happy with my time today.
These people set the goals that seemed far-fetched. Now we're gonna see that those things are really coming to fruition.
We went to California with this class. We went skiing.
That was a ridiculous confidence booster. Like this is gonna happen. I'm gonna do this. I'm gonna succeed at it.
I was really interested to see how skiing without a leg was gonna work.
Can do a sweeping left.
It's really fun to watch dudes with no legs just shredding it down the mountain, man. I mean, if that don't make you smile, I don't know what else will.
Mike will tell you, he's not as good as he was when he had both arms. In fact, he's actually better than he was with two arms.
Like losing my arm, that's probably the best thing that could ever happen to me. I would never have Olympic dreams at all.
That may sound insane, but I've heard it time and time again.
A lot of people ask if I would go back and change, if I would stop myself from enlisting because of my injuries and stuff, and I would tell them no. I've adapted and, you know, I'm doing well.
I've experienced it in my journey too. Sometimes when you go through the adversity of losing part of who you are, you find an even better part of who you are, and it redefines you.
My daughters, they don't see these men and women as amputees. I see them as people. My two-year-old, every night at dinner, start by praying, and I asked her to thank God for three things she's thankful for. She thanks God every single night for Brian Aft, for Blake Watson,
and then the third one's interchangeable.
The point is, we're together in this. It's like a big family of people pushing each other, supporting each other, and adapting.
It's not just a gym, like I said, it's the camaraderie. Everyone's family. Everyone's family's family. And so everyone's treated that way here. And it's just really cool. It's really special.
A new kind of courage. Sponsored by your North Texas GMC dealers and Veterans Land Board.